Hey everyone, this is Lynn Bartim, and you are listening to the Apex Hour on KSUU Thunder 91.1. In this show, you get more personal time with the guests who visit Southern Utah University from all over, learning more about their stories and opinions beyond their presentations on stage. We will also give you some new music to listen to and hope to turn you on to some new sounds and new genres. You can find us here every Thursday at 3 p.m. or on the web at seu.edu/apex. But for now, welcome to this week's show here on Thunder 91.1.
Welcome in, everyone, to another Apex Hour here on KSUU Thunder 91.1. As you've probably noticed, things are a little bit different in the studio today as our fearless leader, Lynn Vartan, unfortunately could not be here, but that's all right. I am here to fill in. My name is Amelia Naumann, and I'm a student right here at SUU, and I've worked for Apex for this entire semester. And let me tell you, it has been such a phenomenal opportunity to see speakers come from all over. But I have to say, today definitely takes the cake for one of my favorite events all year. I am joined in the studio today with Dr. Donna J. Nielsen, who has a resume that is so great, so phenomenal, and I am so excited to dive in and talk a little bit more about Breaking Bad and, of course, other experiences you've had in the world of chemistry. So, Donna, how are you?
Oh, I'm doing great. Thank you so much for hosting me here. I have enjoyed this visit so much.
Oh, I am so glad. That is what we like to hear. Well, for our audience, I'm going to just read a little spiel about you just so they kind of become a little bit more acquainted with you before we really dive into the conversation. So for those who were unable to attend our Apex event today, Dr. Nielsen got to talk about her phenomenal experiences being the scientific director and like consultant for the hit AMC TV show Breaking Bad. However, she has accomplished so many other things. And again, I'm excited to dive into those. And so I'm just going to read you a couple of the things that she's done, but I highly, highly encourage you to give her a Google because my goodness, what a phenomenal resume. Some of the things that Dr. Nielsen has accomplished in her career is being the American Chemical Society president in 2016, which, by the way, is the world's largest scientific society with over 150,000 members. She is the fellow of the Royal Society of Chemistry. She has an honorary doctorate from the University of Edinburgh. She has the Guggenheim Fellowship and has been awarded several awards in the National Organization of Women, and most specifically the Woman of Courage Award in 2004. So Donna, I wanted to ask you a little bit more about some of your background with the American Chemical Society, because as someone who doesn't know a lot about chemistry, it was absolutely amazing to do a deep dive into kind of what they do. So how did you become acquainted with the society, and how did you work your way up to being president?
So I first became acquainted with the society in the same way that most chemists do, and that is while I was an undergraduate. I joined as an undergraduate in school. And it turns out that that's how most of the students do. And of course, you find out about those things from your professors. And, of course, we always follow all of the advice of our professors. And so that's how I joined. And then, you know, you just spend years, with it because it offers, the American Chemical Society offers so many things to its members. And so you just naturally want to go to the national meetings and the regional meetings and experience meeting other professors, meeting other members. And you go to the exposition and you get to see so much equipment being demonstrated. And it's just a way to keep up in your field. I might mention also that these national meetings of the American Chemical Society can have up to 20,000 attendees in one city. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
For that week. Yes. And so it is definitely an opportunity to meet a lot of people.
Oh, for sure. That networking is absolutely phenomenal. So that's amazing that you've been involved in this organization since undergrad, like starting out as just a resume builder and turning into a big part of your career. So how did you kind of work up to being president, and what are some of the experiences you had while serving as the president?
So, well, you have to hold certain positions in order for people to even think about voting for you for president. So the American Chemical Society has a lot of different local chapters, et cetera. So I was chair of those and serve on different committees and serve on different technical divisions. And just bit by bit, you learn a lot. But so the Breaking Bad ended in 2013, and mm-hmm. I was science advisor for Breaking Bad. And so in 2013, people were saying, oh, Donna, you've got to run for ACS president. And, you know, students can vote. And so they said, you've got to run. You'll have to run in 2014 while everything is still fresh in their minds. And that's what I did. And I got elected pretty easily. So I would say that there is a connection between being Breaking Bad science advisor and being ACS president.
Oh, that's great that those two like completely flowed together. That's, yeah. That's
well, it's
so
name
great.
Recognition.
Name recognition. That is so, so, so important. Well, I absolutely love that. Kind of speaking of name recognition, I wanted to let our listeners know that you were named like in the top 70 most inspirational women leaders impacting the world. And you've written over 200 research-related publications, and you've given hundreds of presentations and national meetings, and you've presented at universities all across the world. So do you have any specific experiences that you would like to share with our audience a little bit about specific meetings or things that have been standouts in your career?
Well, I can remember one that was sort of strange. It was the national meeting of the Japanese Chemical Society. So many countries sent their chemical society presidents to this meeting. So there was the president of the Taiwanese Chemical Society, the Korean Chemical Society, the Chinese Chemical Society, the New Zealand Chemical Society, the Australian Chemical, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so, of course, they were all men except for me. So wow. I was the only female president of a chemical society there. And so we were all in one large room talking, and people came to me and said, you know, there's a lot of female chemists in this room next door, and we would really like for you to go over and say a few words to them. They're really wanting to meet you. And I said, okay, great, let me go. So we went over, and I was meeting them. And then after I had been there a few minutes, a person, I don't remember who, came up and said, are you aware that you're going to be speaking in front of the whole meeting, including all of these presidents of these chemical societies? And I said, no, I didn't know I was supposed to do that. And they said, well, you are. And so I was thinking, oh, my God. And I said, oh, that's wonderful. And so I was also thinking, well, I wonder when this is. I wonder how much time I have to prepare a few remarks, you know, just to think about some things. And so I said, well, when is it? And they said, oh, it's now. And so I said, oh, great. And so I was thinking, I wonder how far I need to walk, because maybe I'll be able to think up some words while I'm walking there. And I said, how far is it? And she said, oh, it's just next door. And so we were able to just walk next door. But I was able to, you know, collect my thoughts and some ideas to speak. But that's sort of having to be constantly ready to speak and represent your society was something that I wasn't really prepared for initially.
Right.
But you have to learn it. You have to learn it. And I saw a politician friend of mine a couple of weeks later when I had returned, and I mentioned that to him, and I said, I bet this happens to you all the time. And he said, yep, several times a day. So it's just a process of learning.
Oh, for sure. In that process, was that just trial and error, or did you take any specific steps to kind of always be ready?
Well, it was, you know, it's immersion. I mean, right. That I had never experienced what I just described until right then. So you just have to grow into it.
Oh, wow. That is so great.
Yeah, there was no preparation at all.
Just throw yourself in. I like that, you know, kind of jump in and learn to swim.
Or get dragged in.
Even better, even better. I was like kind of going back to what you said just before that. I love that story so much. But throughout your career, you have constantly and consistently been oftentimes the only woman in the room. And kind of what are some of your experiences when you walk into a room or you walk into a classroom and you realize that you are the token, you are the one who kind of sets an example. So kind of what are some of your thoughts on when you walk in and you realize that you kind of have to stand alone in your own right? Where do you go from there? Like, how do you handle that?
Well, yes, that has happened to me. It happened a lot, especially starting out. I never really thought of myself as a token because it just happened. And I would certainly say my advice would be don't ever let it hold you back. Go in and function and, don't dwell on it. Don't even think about it. Just go in and do what you need to do and perform, to the best of your ability as you always do. And that's what I've always done. And I would certainly say, by all means, don't let it worry you.
Right. Oh, that's
so just
great.
Go for it.
Go for it. Oh, that is so great. That is so phenomenal. Ooh, okay. I was like, I think that's the perfect time for our first song break. Here on the Apex Hour, we get to do phenomenal interviews with our guests, but we also hope to turn you on to some new sounds. So all of these songs today have been featured on the hit TV show Breaking Bad because we love a theme here on the Apex Hour. And this is On a Clear Day.
Rise and look around you, and you will see who you are. On a clear day, how it will astound you that the glow of your being outshines every star. You'll feel part of every mountain, sea and shore, and you can hear from far and near a world you've never before. But on that clear day, on that clear day, you can see forever and ever, ever.
Perfect. Welcome back in, everyone. That was On a Clear Day by The Peddlers, and all songs featured on this Apex Hour have been featured on the hit TV show AMC's Breaking Bad. I'm joined today in the studio by Dr. Donna J. Nilsen, who was the scientific advisor on Breaking Bad, among doing so many other things. She has worked in so many societies, other TV shows, almost anything you can imagine, which does lead me to my next question, which is, Donna, you've accomplished so many things, so many phenomenal things, from awards to research projects. And before you kind of embark on something, before you decide to do something, because there's only so many hours in a day, how do you decide what's worth your time and what projects you're going to take on next?
Well, thank you so much for those kind words. I would say that, of course, you have to look, you know, research it thoroughly. The number one thing, if you're looking for a research project, you don't want to go in and start doing something that someone else has already done.
Right.
So you need to research your idea thoroughly to see if it's already been reported in the literature, because you want to do something that's new. And also, for me, anyway, I try to do things that are significant. You know, you wouldn't want to spend a lot of time doing something that nobody's going to be interested in. And you want your research project to be affordable. You don't
right.
want to get into it and then realize that you can't afford this research project and you can't get money to fund it. So it needs yeah. to be something that is significant, something that is affordable, something that will benefit a lot of people, preferably. And so if you'll think about it, remember the on my last slide of the talk I just gave.
Yes.
It was the look for the gaps quotation
yes.
by Steve Jobs. And so it was just like he said, you know, you want to do things that people need, that are affordable, that are capable of being done, and that will benefit people.
Oh, for sure. And that is absolutely phenomenal points. So for those who are unable to go to the talk, will you just give like a little elevator pitch of, I thought this was so fascinating, on how you ended up going onto the set of Breaking Bad just by how you found that magazine. And if you could just like tell a brief little part of that for those who are unable to make it to the talk.
Well, sure. I'm often asked, how is it that you, located in Oklahoma, managed to have contact with the writers and Vince Gilligan, who were located in Burbank? Because after all, Burbank is in California. And it really had nothing to do with proximity. It is, again, it's a sort of a pitch for the American Chemical Society, which yeah. is near and dear to my heart. So the American Chemical Society magazine, Chemical and Engineering News, had a story that was featuring an interview of Vince Gilligan, the producer of Breaking Bad. And so in it, he said, we would appreciate constructive comments from a chemically inclined audience. And I looked at that and I thought, oh, wow, this is an invitation to assist them. And I was thinking in the back of my mind, what an opportunity to be able to influence them and possibly make them realize the value that science and scientists have to our country. And so I had to think about it for a little bit because I thought, well, you know, this show is about meth. And so I watched the episodes, and that's when I realized, well, there were a lot of morals in that show. And so then I realized, well, I could be associated with it. And then I thought again about the what it could mean to be able to bring good science to the show. And so I got back with the person who had written the story. And I said, would you be willing to send a message to them that if they want to volunteer, they have one. I'll volunteer to help them. And then they got back in touch with me. So that's it really in a nutshell.
Oh, that's perfect. And what was it like kind of breaking into Hollywood? Because that is a completely different sphere than the world of academia that I'm sure you are used to.
Oh, it's a different world.
it's a different world.
Yes, it really is. And I would say for anybody that's interested, you have to be flexible. That is the number one thing. You have to be flexible and align your goals. If you do get lucky enough to work with one of the one of the groups that's putting together a show or has a show, you have to align your goals with theirs. In other words, their goal will be to get picked up next season. And so you need to align your goals with theirs and make certain that you help them. And other than that, it was just a tremendous amount of fun. It was such a learning experience for me. I had a great time. It was a new world, and I would thoroughly recommend it to anyone who gets the opportunity.
Oh, that's great. What were some of your favorite experiences, either with the writers or even just on set?
Well, one thing that I remember that made such, I don't know that it was a favorite, but it sticks in my mind and forever will, that when I would get introduced, when Vince would introduce me to people, they would usually look at me and they would respond with, "You're not a scientist." And I would say, "Yes, I am," you know. And they would say, no, you're not a scientist." And I'd say, you know, and we would argue about it a bit. And they would say, "No, you're not a scientist." And I'd say, "Yes, I am. I am a tenured professor of organic chemistry. I assure you, I am a scientist." And so we had to have this little dance, it seemed like, all the time. And so I eventually realized that they didn't picture scientists as looking like I look. And I realize now that that in itself is a way to impact Hollywood, to make these writers and producers and directors and even the people that handle the props, to make them realize that scientists can be women also, yes. You know, and can have nice looking hair and wear makeup and things like this. So that's one thing that stuck in my mind. Of course, I didn't let it hold me back for a minute.
No, not at all.
but it is a fun thing to think back on.
Oh, that's absolutely phenomenal. Do you have any other experiences on set specifically or meeting anyone, like any of the actors, that was kind of like a really fun moment?
Yeah, one other thing that was really funny. I remember when Bryan Cranston, you know, of course, was playing Walter White. Right. And so in between takes, maybe they would have a take inside a room and they would have to knock the wall out of that room and put up another wall so that they could do the take again at a 90-degree angle to the original take. And while they were changing the walls, Bryan Cranston would have to stay in character. And,
wow.
You know, they get in character, they go in, and they have these takes made of them. And so the actors have to stay in character. And so he might have to stay in character for a couple of minutes while they're not knocking out a wall and putting up a fresh wall so that they can change the direction of the camera. And I remember one time he walked over to me, and I could see that he was staying in character. And he looked at me and he said, "Have you read any good chemistry articles recently?" You know, he was staying
oh
in character.
Goodness.
And I turned and I said, "Yeah, I have. I've read some good ones in the Journal of Organic Chemistry." And he said, "Good. We'll have to talk about them later."
Oh, that is so great.
And so, you know, it just, for me, I had never thought about that need. And so that's what I mean. It was a great learning experience for me. I enjoyed this so much. I learned to really respect actors and directors and the producers. I have an immense respect for them after seeing the different talents that they need to have in order to have a hit show.
Oh, for sure. Did you really just consult with the writers, or did you ever get to actually sit down with any of the actors and talk about chemistry?
Yeah. Well, no, they wouldn't want to talk about chemistry. They weren't chemists.
He was just saying
that to be able to stay in character. But I did get to meet them all. So when I was on set, you know, I would go in the morning at the same time that everybody reported. And so there would be the directors and the often the producers and all of the actors and the stagehands, et cetera. And so I would get to watch the filming, which was fabulous. I learned so much. A major thing to learn is to be quiet while they are filming. and then there would be break for lunch. And we would all go over to the lunch cars and just sit intermingled with each other. So sometimes I would sit next to, you know, Bryan Cranston, or sometimes I would sit next to one of the stagehands or maybe one of the directors. Everybody just, you know, filed in and sat next to each other. It was like one big happy family, and everybody got along fabulously.
Oh, that's
everybody
great.
Was so nice to each other. I really enjoyed that aspect of it.
Yeah, that's phenomenal. Was it really easy to kind of be accepted into this community as you walked in as a scientific advisor? Because usually in Hollywood, we don't see a lot of advising, and it's really just Googling, and that's how you write your show. So was it easy to be accepted into these communities?
They did completely.
Oh.
They were absolutely fabulous, so friendly, and I really enjoyed it. Now, I think it might be because of my interactions with the writers. I respected them immensely, and so they respected me. And so we got along great. It was only a wonderful experience.
Oh, that is so phenomenal. I absolutely love that. What are some of the other TV shows and other experiences that you've been able to have since Breaking Bad? Because I know you've continued to consult in the world of arts in Hollywood.
Yeah. So I did make a couple of set visits for Big Bang Theory, which was fun, but it was entirely different because that was done to a live audience.
True.
Whereas
yes.
Breaking Bad was not. And so there, you even have to have additional cautions to, stay out of sight and things like this. You have to be more careful. And that was a lot of fun. Their science advisor was just an immensely wonderful friend. And, I had a great time with that. So for me, I still regarded it as a learning experience.
Oh, that is so great. And then what other experiences have you had in the worlds of like consulting or even just going around and speaking about your experience with Breaking Bad?
Well, I have lost track long ago of how many talks I've given,
yeah.
on Breaking Bad. And it has been several years.
Right.
I did in one case a tour of Germany where I was there something like a total of 8 days. You fly in one day, do a tour of 6 different cities, one
wow.
per day for the next 6 days, and you fly out the next day. And that was, I really just sort of did that to see if I could. It was
yeah.
a test of my stamina, and it was a great experience. The German students loved Breaking Bad. There is no other way to say it. I never experienced anything like my talks with them anyplace else, because the students would come to my presentations dressed in hazmat suits, which is totally unique.
Oh, man.
They really love Breaking Bad. So, I've just given so many talks to so many universities, and it's I've been very lucky. It was a wonderful, fortunate experience, and I'm just so glad that I had this experience and I was able to bring it to the scientific community, because I can tell you this, it's a lot easier to have me come in and speak to your university than it would be to have Bryan Cranston or Aaron Paul, because Bryan Cranston and Aaron Paul would be so much more in demand, and it would be much more difficult to get in touch with them. My email address is a lot more available.
Oh, that is so great. Awesome. I think that is the perfect segue into our next song break, and all of the songs on this hour have been featured on the TV show Breaking Bad. This is 1977.
Nací un día de junio del año 77, planeta Mercurio y el año de la serpiente. Signo patente tatuado y en mi frente que en el vientre de mi madre marcaba el paso siguiente. Nacer y llorar sin anestesia en la camilla, mi padre solo dijo es Ana María. Sí sería el primer llanto que me probaría, que mandó las heridas y dándome la batería. Solía ser entonces como un libro abierto, pero leí la letra pequeña del texto, como un arquitecto construyendo cada efecto. Correcto, incorrecto, se aprende todo al respecto. Saber que algunas personas quieren el daño, subir peldaño toma tiempo, toma año.
con mi peluche mirando lo cotidiano. Dibujos transformaban el invierno en gran verano. Papá me regaló bajo mi insistencia un juego que trataba de compartir la solvencia. Pero en el patio hicieron la competencia. Fue cuando sentí mi primera impotencia. 1970 y 1970 y 1970. 1977, no me diga no, que no lo presiento. Todo lo que cambia lo hará diferente en el año que nace la sepia. 1977, no me diga no, que no lo presiento. Todo lo que cambia lo hará diferente en el año que nace la sepia. Adolescencia fue una etapa avisar. El cuerpo es batería y la cabeza guitar. La orquesta narra una tonada quebrada para la mirada de una niña que solo talla espada. Hormona disparada, sobrepobladas de información que cambian temporadas. Caminas encrucijada, cada cual en su morada preparaba la carnada. La sagrada diablada de mirada encabronada. Mi fila en la verdad nunca buscó su silla. Mi búsqueda fue mero proceso de pura pila. Pupila de poeta que marcó nuestra saliva en la cordillera que miraba la salida. La parada militar de paso monótono, colores policromo, los uniformes de poco tono. De tono mi cuestionamiento, la voz hizo no, no. Mi primera rima que sonó y me enroló. Mi búsqueda no fue para mi cosa de escenario. Fue algo necesario y que marchaba ya mi fallo. Así que tú hablas más de lo necesario. Fue cuando entendí que todos quieren ser corsario. 1970 y 1970 y 1970. 1977. No me diga no, que no lo presiento. Todo lo que cambia lo hará diferente en el año que nació la sepia. 1977, no me diga no, que no lo presiento. Todo lo que cambia lo hará diferente en el año que nació la sepia.
Perfect. Welcome back in, everyone, to the Apex Hour here on KSUU Thunder 91.1. I'm in the studio today with Dr. Donna J. Nelson, who is a phenomenal chemist who it has been such a privilege to have you on campus. One of the next things that we're going to talk about has been quite a point of interest in some of the class visits and a couple of the other things that we've been able to do with Dr. Nelson, and those are the Nelson Diversity Surveys. And Dr. Nelson, I will not do it justice, so tell me a little bit about what those are and kind of how they came to be.
Sure. So the Nelson Diversity Surveys, let me start at the beginning. They are a set of surveys which show the headcount of the faculties of 15 different STEM departments at each of the top 100 departments. So, for example, the top 100 chemistry departments, top 100 physics departments, top 100 math departments, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so we contacted the department chairs of all of those departments and asked them to tell us their tenured and tenure track faculty headcount disaggregated by race, by rank, and by gender. And so the goal here was to determine, to quantify, actually, the representation of these faculties and to see how many minorities and how many women were present. And then once you get the numbers, you can tell what the percentages are. So we were wanting to see if the underrepresented minorities were being hired in at the same rate as they were being produced in PhD programs. And so, of course, you know, the hiring was lower than the PhD production. The percentage of hiring was lower than the PhD production. So the representation of minorities among assistant professors was lower, much lower than the representation of underrepresented minorities among the PhD recipients. And so that empowered minorities to be able to talk about the their representation and to assist themselves. And so in that way, I think of it as a gift to the scientific community the minority communities because it empowered them. In the before that, minorities would say, well, you know, it seems like there's not many of us. But once you have the numbers, you can go in and say, here's the numbers. Why are we being hired in such low numbers?
Yeah. When did you first get the idea to start on this project? Because that's a huge undertaking, collecting all of that data. So when was the kind of linchpin moment of like, this is something I'm going to do?
That was late in the year 2000. And we reported our first data in early in 2001. And so it really made headlines. We surveyed chemistry chairs. And let me just say that if you're wanting to know the representation of underrepresented minorities, you have to have the full populations. So in other words, you've probably heard people talk about surveys they did and they'd say, we got 63% participation or we got 78% participation. Isn't that wonderful? Well, if you need the whole population, it's 100% participation, which is almost impossible.
Yeah.
But you have to have that because if you've got underrepresented minorities and you want to reveal the numbers of, say, black women Hispanic women who are assistant professors or even Native Americans, you have to have the whole population because the numbers are so tiny and sometimes the numbers are zero.
Yeah.
And so we did that and It enabled those groups to be able to talk about accurately to talk about the situations.
Oh, that is so phenomenal and something that is so empowering. And I know it's something that is still looked at today. What are some of the current projects that you're embarking on? Because as we've talked about throughout this hour, you've done so many phenomenal things. So what are you currently working on?
Well, I'm always thinking about how, you know, communities.
Yes.
So my work with Breaking Bad, that was to benefit the scientific community, to try to bring it to the general public, how scientists and science are benefiting them. And so for the Nelson Diversity Surveys, that was a gift to the minority communities so that they would to empower them so that they could move themselves forward. And now I'm doing work on chemical education. I just sort of follow wherever I see a need and an opportunity, something that I can do, that I think I can actually do and do reasonably that will make a difference and benefit a community. And like Steve Jobs said, you know, that is needed, affordable, is possible,
yes,
et cetera, et cetera.
Oh, that's great. So kind of what are some of the steps that you're taking currently to kind of accomplish that?
So what I do is I give surveys to my class at the beginning of the course and at the end of the course. These are surveys that measure their mindsets and their personality traits. And I compare the before and after, and I can see how what I've taught to the students has influenced them. And so I just find that's very interesting that in one semester, it is possible to have a huge impact on students. And that makes me feel really good. And so I want to explore that because I teach organic chemistry, and in organic chemistry, I had pre-med, pre-vet, pre-dent, pre-pharmacy students. And
right,
it's just very important that they have honesty, ethics, integrity, and egalitarianism. And so this is a way to ensure that I am indeed presenting material to them that will develop those characteristics in those students. And we do want our next generation of doctors and dentists, et cetera, to have those characteristics.
Oh, for sure. And as a student myself, that is so fascinating to hear that you can really make a change in that semester.
Yeah, and it surprised me too.
Yeah, you would never think just in like a few short months that you could make that happen. So as a student, and I know for the other students listening, what is your advice for as you kind of embark on your career and you really want to have these traits that I know are super important to you, like honesty and integrity? How do you kind of keep that as a balance in your life? And how do you, just any advice you have for students?
Yeah, well, I would say to think about it, you know, think about those things, and you have to make the correct choices. And also you need to get the correct role models, you know.
Ooh,
so
yeah.
Because you will grow to resemble the people that you spend a lot of time around. And
true.
So you know, you want to select role models who will have or who do have the same characteristics that you want to have yourself. And I don't mean necessarily being in the same area of science, but I just
right.
mean having the same personality characteristics. And so it is very important not only to get the correct discipline of science, but also to get the correct characteristics in your role models. At least that's my belief. So that's one thing I would recommend.
Oh, that's great. And who are some of your role models or people who have impacted your life?
Well, my PhD mentor, my postdoctoral mentor, unfortunately, they both passed away now, but I was impacted greatly by those. And I was very fortunate that my PhD mentor was Michael Dewar, who was a true genius and a very fine person. My postdoc mentor was H.C. Brown, a very famous chemist and a Nobel laureate. And
wow.
he was an excellent person as well. And, you know, you can also learn about people by watching certain movies, I mean, or certain films about those people, like Benjamin Franklin, George Washington.
Yes.
You know, so notice these aren't chemists. Well, Benjamin Franklin was a scientist. But, you know, there are many famous people and excellent role models that you can learn about. You can learn about their characteristics by watching documentaries about them. And so you don't actually have to meet them, which would be very difficult in the case of Benjamin Franklin, you know, although I would love, he would probably be the number one person I would love to meet if I could meet anybody from any time period.
Oh, that's so great. And then what were some of the role models you had in your family life that led you to become a chemist?
Well, my father was an MD, and his father was an MD, and so I originally thought I was going to be an MD.
Yes.
And so I learned a lot from those people who, after all, have certain scientific characteristics, and my mother also influenced me greatly. She was the one that was always sort of driving me or pushing me until, you know, telling me that I could be and do anything that I wanted to be or do. And she had an extreme amount of confidence in me. And I think that she was the one who conveyed to me that she had all these expectations of me and never even hinted to me that I would be held back at all because I was a female.
Oh, that's so phenomenal. Well, thank you so much for sharing about your personal role models and about honesty and integrity, because that is something that I'm sure we all need a little bit more of in our life. That is going to lead us into our next song break. And all of these songs have been featured on the hit TV show Breaking Bad. And this is Stay on the Outside by Whitney. This is KSUU Thunder 91.1.
Should have been 1, 2, 3, but recently something has happened to me. Everything always came easily, but today I woke up and felt nothing. Could I be finally finding out that there's absolutely nothing worth shouting about? Facing the choice of just losing my voice, I'd rather shut up and say nothing. On the outside, we have to stick together. On the downside, you just get in the way. I see gray skies, and I feel a little better. I see gray skies ahead, and it's fine by me. Oh, all the right people seem squeaky clean, well, all the right
nothing of me. Cheating and creeping just to stay on track. They'll offer one hand to put a knife in your back. You notice that something is terribly wrong. When they offer the world, then they turn and they're gone. Then you from the start, you could never belong. You came from the outside, you'll stay on the outside.
Welcome back in, everyone, to the Apex Hour here on KSUU Thunder 91.1. As always, this hour has gone by much too quickly. So, Dr. Donna J. Nielsen, I have one last question for you. And this question is, what is lighting your fire this week? And this can be anything related to science or anything not related.
Well, I have really enjoyed this trip to your university. The people are so nice. And so that is what has lit my fire, just being here and socializing with all of the extremely intelligent and kind people. And the students also who came to my talk and turned out for so many talks, you know, so many meetings, and they were also well attended. I really appreciated that. So I was really impressed by this fabulous visit to Southern Utah University. So thank you so much.
Well, thank you so much. It has been such a privilege to have you. Thank you all so much for tuning in. This is KSUU Thunder 91, and this has been the Apex Hour with Dr. Donna J. Nielsen, and we will see you all next week.
Thanks so much for listening to the Apex Hour here on KSUU Thunder 91.1. Come find us again next Thursday at 3 p.m. for more conversations with the visiting guests at Southern Utah University and new music to discover for your next playlist. And in the meantime, we would love to see you at our events on campus. To find out more, check out suu.edu/apex. Until next week, this is Lynn Vartan saying goodbye from the Apex Hour here on Thunder 91.1.